Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back. We are here with more BTS series and some more European games and lots more Dota to be had. I'm Connell Guy. I'm here with this guy right here. It's Blaze. Blaze, it's going to be an exciting day of more exciting Dota.
Yeah, I'm really excited about it. Yesterday was amazing. I mean, we got to see a really great matchup in FNM versus Power Rangers. We got to see a really fun match at the conclusion of the day. So, yeah, Dota 2 brings just all sorts of fun.
And surprises.
Yeah.
And today, we actually do have a small surprise. Let's go ahead and hop into the draft. And if you weren't here at the start and didn't have the chance to check over the rosters for these teams, you'll see that there's an interesting new face among us right now. So, Blaze, let us know that according to the Flipside Tactics manager, unfortunately, their prized player, Sadoy, feeling a bit under the weather. So, they had to settle for a stand-in. And Dendi happened to be available, Blaze. So he's here. He'll be playing for Flipside, going against Escape Gaming, TI competitors. And they were one of the first teams to say, hey, we're staying together.
Yep, exactly. So it's going to be a pretty big showdown between these two teams. A lot of viewers hyped up for this one. I'm hyped up for it as well. There's a lot of potential between both sides here. I mean, Escape, obviously, they were the ones that were able to make it to the forefront of the international. Flipside, well, they haven't really been able to make a name for themselves under this brand. You look at these names, and these guys have been in the CIS Dota scene for a very long time.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, TMW, Tame My Wild, I feel that at one point he was actually the best mid player in the West. But, like, he's had his ups and downs for sure. And Dendi has always challenged him for that throne. Had that throne for himself, rather. But either way, like, I feel like there's so much potential between these individual players. I really like the team that Vanscora has put together, and TMW is actually going to be drafting it up for the side here. So I wanted to talk about, like, Flipside strats and their overall game plan, hero pools, whatever, but it kind of goes out the window when you have a standard. So we'll just have to see exactly what they feel most comfortable picking in this situation. And right now it's just going to be the IO opener, and I would consider the Nyx more just a counter to the Caudal that Cinnarin's going to be playing.
And let me tell you, it's a real pain in the ass of a counter, too. I have played many a Caudal games and against a certain Nyx Assassin, and it feels like everything he has just ruins your day. I mean, the mana leak goes without saying, but you're casually just trying to blast down waves, blast down jungle creeps, and lo and behold, a Nyx Assassin's there, and it's so easy to pop that carapace. You reflect back all of that damage, an easy stun. He's such an easy, like, vendetta-striking target because he's frail and old and his bones are made of sand. It's just, it's a hard time and it's a hard life. So I can't really fault Flipside to really take it to Caudal. And, yeah, you typically don't want to have something so direct countering towards something as flimsy as a support. But I mean, Caudal is a meta shifter in a game itself, so a lot of attention could be rightfully deserved. To go back a bit on the note as far as obviously Flipside sporting the Dendi stand-in here, what do you feel about him feeling the shoes of someone like Sadoy? Do you think they fit kind of that same mid lane profile? Do they have a similar hero pool? You know, I'm curious to see if it is kind of all out the window for their captain, or if Dendi can kind of fill those same shoes.
It's hard to say, because, like, to me, I still look at Sadoy as an offlaner. I still look at his hero pool as something that, like, he's always looking to be more active, more flexible, and more dynamic across the map. But obviously, more recently, he's been playing more harder carries, more scalable heroes, and in general, heroes that can snowball really well. So I feel like Dendi can still fit that profile, but in his own unique flair. It's not going to be the normal Flipside game plan. I think they're going to have to augment it a little bit, make it a Dendi-centric one, perhaps, and just make it work for them.
I'm curious to see what a more Dendi-centric kind of a draft would be. Some of the things I think about is, like, maybe utilizing his strong capabilities with someone who can really set the stage and initiate, like a Magnus, and amplify a lot of their core potential, or if they're going to play around the idea of, like, you know, like his TA game, where he could just kind of really be able to just snowball in the mid game, be a free fighter, and just kind of hold the momentum for them to kind of segue into hopefully a win. So we'll have to see what the case is. For Escape, you know, things are a bit more, I don't want to say cut and dry, because when we look back to Escape and, like, their run for their TI6 qualifier, people were identifying them with a pretty, I don't want to say simplistic, but pretty obvious kind of playstyle at the time. We saw a lot of Yabzor Enigma. We saw a lot of just huge wombo combo, Kezu, Darkseer, and they would be able to hold the high ground so well and just kind of cater to their own game plan. But through their run at TI itself, they were showing some adaptability. Now, obviously, they weren't able to kind of finish with any sort of strong, you know, placement, but they made it, which is definitely a lot more than pretty much everyone else in this BTS series can say. So, on that note, they should be coming in heavy favorites for the tournament overall.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see what the Dendy factor goes into, but I'm trying to think about how to draft against Quokka's Lone Druid. That's always been a question that a lot of teams have been asking themselves. Most teams will just prefer to ban it. We'll just say, okay, well, there are counters in the pool. There are ways to answer this hero, but it's just so hard. Why don't we just take it out? But in this case, it has been left in. Drow, ET were the bans from Flipside, so they have to deal with not only Cinder and Scuttle, which they seem to have an answer for here in the Knicks, but also this Lone Druid. I like Witch Doctor personally against Lone Druid. I think that if he's there we go! Awesome!
Ooh, but, Blaze the Oracle. Very nice.
All right, but it's just a hero that actually works really well, because Lone Druid needs to keep a certain amount of spacing between himself and the bear, and it's usually pretty well coincides with Paralyzing Cast's range to bounce back and forth. So you can control the bear really well with this. If you're trying to lay a lot of big damage into him, you can maledict the bear as well, and you could just burn it down. So I actually really like the Witch Doctor. He's got a good ability to just kind of put him, root himself in place and get a good ultimate out of a distance. Yeah, there are things like Savage Roar you have to worry about, or even the Beastmaster's Roar here, but usually those are going to be on other higher priority targets. The Witch Doctor can kind of stay back, just throw a cask out, and do his thing. So I really like it.
Oh, yeah.
I also look at the Lone Druid as having a certain amount of damage output. If he doesn't have the Battle Cry active, then he shouldn't be able to burst down a hero that's protected by Voodoo Restoration. So between the Wisp Witch Doctor having the Tether Voodoo heals, as well as just the ability to control these heroes through the Nyx and the Witch Doctor, I actually really like Flipside's draft.
Pretty much a lot of those elements you were saying on why Witch Doctor is so good against Lone Druid could also be applied to Beastmaster in a laning phase. So it's like, you got those two things going for you. Maybe Flipside also saying, oh, we could be denying the Witch Doctor, which could be also a solid pick for escape when you're going against the Wisp. All the stars align. This is a Witch Doctor time here and now for Flipside, so I can't really fault you on that. It was a wonderful call and a wonderful pick by them. The question is PA, do you think Flipside were inspired yesterday by Sayoma, and they're going to be rolling Blaze with the roaming PA? If you guys missed yesterday's final game we got to cast, it was Broodmothers versus Vega. Mm-hmm. And I guess mathematically for that match, because Broodmothers were not able to attend game number one, they were automatically already out in the running of making it to the playoffs. So Vega already knew they won no matter what, so they played a ridiculous game. They swapped the roles up. FN Jane Sayoma jumped onto the cores. FN's core, he jumped over support. It was a hilarious time, and it included a four-position roaming PA. It was awesome. Not expecting to see the same thing here for Flipside, but look at this. Escape. Go into a a la carte tiny, as I like to say, not with the Wisp, which for a lot of teams would see a bit peculiar, but Blaze, it's era tiny.
Exactly. This is a tried and true, especially going back to the times of Fnatic. It was No-Tail and Era that really comboed up, and they were one of the like the big original Tiny Wisp duos. There's one in China, and there was one in the West, and obviously Era was the forefront of that. So I really do like the hero. I think that the burst is what they were lacking before. They have the control with the Roar, and like I said, the Lone Druid can put out some good damage when he's battle cried. But generally speaking, you just want to be able to just jump in and beat somebody up. And I think the Tiny has the potential to do that. Even like the Nyx Assassin has trouble carapacing the multiple instances of damage that Tiny puts out. So I really do think that this is going to have an answer for in a lot of ways. The final point I'll mention is that PA has a little bit of trouble dealing with this kind of a lineup, because now not only does she have to worry about entangling roots and the Primal Roar, which go through BKB, but she has to worry about Tiny's craggy exterior if she's trying to go toe-to-toe with him. So Blinding Light's going to be messing with her, craggy, and the two controlling factors of the Lone Druid and Beastmaster. It's actually really tough for the PA to stick to one target, and it's going to be curious to see how she itemizes to kind of circumvent that.
It's like the other option is she could have someone by her side to be able to help out in all those factors. With the already commitment to the Nyx Assassin, which I'm expecting to be the off lane, you can't get that saving grace in, like, let's say, an Omni Knight, or someone to be able to provide that repel or provide that a bit of assistance so she can withstand all of the potential kiting and all the potential trouble that'll be there from escape. Final pickup for them here is going to be the Yapzor hero, and we know him a lot for his Enigma. We also know him a lot, of course, for his Earth Spirit here, but, you know, I'm one of the biggest critics as far as Earth Spirit and where he is in this meta, and I'll continue to say it. I don't feel like he has as strong of a spot as he used to. Everyone used to know the Ebola Spirit for exactly that, being OP, always being first pick, always being first ban. But the game has shifted so much. He used to make such an impact in the early laning phase, in particular towards that mid lane.
Since then, though, we have a lot of elusive heroes, your Muranas, Timber Saws like this and stuff, and it's just become so difficult for that Earth Spirit to make the early game impact that he tends to just fall off because his late game and his farming are just really not there. Now with the final pick coming in, Flipside do commit, as mentioned, for that Timber Saw, a Dendi Timber Saw Blaze to round things out.
Yeah, I wonder if he's just going to mute all his team and just trust in Timber Saw. Might be the way to go. But
that's the envy tactic. I don't know if you saw that little clip. Yeah. He was watching Slacks, and he's like, that's not how I do things. I pick Timber, and I believe in the hero and mute everybody.
But here we are. He's ready to roll. It looks like on the mid lane, he should be matched up here against the Quick Valone Druid. It could be Era's Tiny technically, but without a Wisp to support it, it's much more likely that Era just kind of does his own thing in the safe lane. Builds up relatively quick Blink Echo. Those are going to be the openers for a real Burst Barrage. Because you don't have the mobility provided to you by the Wisp Tether and Relocate, you really kind of have to do it yourself. So Blink Dagger is a necessity, and I think Echo Saber is a pretty good item to build up before you go into the Aghanims. But one thing you got to mention is that when we hit the mid-game stride, when you do have that tiny Aghanim Scepter, the pushing power of this team is absolutely ridiculous. Both the Demolish passive of the Spirit Bear at level 7,
oh, yeah,
as well as the Tiny Aghanims, these are ways to enhance damage directly put out onto buildings, and you've got an attack speed aura in the Inner Beast to boot. So I really do think that what we're going to be looking at is Flipside trying to manage multiple lanes through this relocate, and they're going to have a really good idea of how to take engagements before an enemy just blinks out. They're going to have to find the Lone Druid, get on the Lone Druid, and I lock him down quickly, because otherwise you're going to have a lot of issues with the fact that there's just so much split push and raw push potential with Escape's heroes.
Yeah, and it really does feel like they have all those kind of bases covered so that Escape could be able to dictate the pace of the game. You already just went into how much pushing potential they have, but even to add more on top of that, the Keeper of the Light, the ways to be able to spam out all the waves, keep that pressure across the river and on the side of Flipside. And, heaven forbid, for their sake, if Flipside were ever to kind of add the push pressure, the same kind of lineup also offers a lot of deep push, a lot of ways to kind of work from the high ground a bit. So we'll have to see, though. Again, with the Earth Spirit, I can't help but feel like Escape do have a little bit of pressure to get some work done in the early laning phase, so we'll have to see what they're going to be able to get done. We are going to be starting with a little bit of a pause, like you do in every online game. So with that moment, let me just quickly get everyone up to speed as far as where these two teams do currently stand in the BTS series. Now, these are two Group A teams. We do have four groups. We'll be taking the top team from each of those four groups, and those four teams will go into a single elimination playoff bracket. For Group A, Escape already do have a 2-0 win over Yellow Submarine, so they're sitting, up there at the top along with Friends, who have a 2-0. That 2-0 is actually against Flipside. So you have Escape Gaming with 1-2-0, and for Flipside have a 1-1 split against Yellow Submarine, and then unfortunately, as already mentioned, they were 2-0'd by Friends. So for Flipside to even stand a chance, Blaze, to stay alive in this group, they have to win not one, but pretty much both of these games.
Yeah, I think 2-0 is definitely the recipe to get Flipside back into the groups. Obviously, that would set back Escape quite a bit as well against not only Flipside, but their rivals and Friends. So yeah, I'm excited to see how it all pans out here as we get to see actually a doubleheader from Escape today. This is pretty much going to determine how the group plays out these next four games for Escape. So really looking forward to it. For now, Yapzor goes for a really cool ward that...
They have both the same ward, by the way. It's like a mirror set of wards. They both came to the mid lane TP, and they both split. Both got the same ward down.
But what I really like about the Earth Spirit is that on Dire side is that this is something that China started doing first around the time of the Middle Major. Actually scouted this, coached it for my team, and we started using it. But essentially what you can do is you TP, smoked or not, you TP to the mid lane, you're rolling boulder across the river, and you can get into a position, drop a ward here. You can even get it even deeper. Like, you can get all the way over here, into the central jungle area. Like, there are so many different spots that you can place a ward when you have a Dire side Earth Spirit level 1 with a TP. So really like that maneuver here from Yapzor. It is, like you said, going to be mirrored a bit by the ward place out by Roger on the Witch Doctor. But yeah, it's going to be a lot of jungle focus coming in from Flipside. As you see, both Observer wards are in that area of the map.
Definitely both teams looking to be keen on where their opponents are going to be moving, where they're going to look to shift. Both of them find their laning phase pretty damn sacred and want to be prepared for any sort of trouble. Sound of the horn, leads underway, and we have a ball game.
Runes are going to be split a piece here. Dendi grabs up one to take it back towards that mid lane matchup, which seems like, for now, Era is going to be grabbing the bounty and heading back towards the mid lane. So it is going to be a mid Tiny versus Timbersaw Blaze. I suppose they find that matchup just a bit better than the Lone Druid, or maybe this is something they intended all along. I'm not too sure.
There's a couple of factors that go into it. One thing is that Tiny has a ridiculous amount of base damage. The fact is, he is sitting on 68 damage. This Timbersaw is only going to be running 53. So while they both have poor man's shields and they both have their own ways of mitigating things, when the Whirling Death is inactive, Tiny is just going to absolutely destroy in last hitting and harassing. When the Whirling Death is active, however, because Tiny is a strength hero, it does mean that it's going to be about fairly even in terms of base damage, and obviously the Tiny is going to take a lot more direct damage from the Timber. So it comes down to Dendi making sure that his mana pool stays sustained so he can keep that Whirling Death up on his opponent. It does last 14 seconds on a 6-second cooldown, so he should be able to keep that fairly involved and make it more difficult for Era to last hit. But end of the day, I actually expect Tiny to do pretty well here, especially because there's more rotation power before level 6.
Now, what about for the other side, at flip side, their scalability here? I mean, it can't help but feel like there is going to be pressure on them for that mid-game to really be able to succeed, to really expect a, you know, show-stopping performance by a Dendi Timbersaw, because I don't know how many eggs you want to put into a late-game PA basket. Is there still that kind of factor with the PA Blaze that you don't really want to put everything into your RNG?
Well, it's not just RNG. It's also an item called, simple item called Silver Edge. You go that on the Tiny, maybe another hero, but probably just the Tiny. And it's going to be actually very difficult for the PA to compete, just because when she breaks her evasion, breaks her crit, that hero is not nearly the hero that you pick it for. And I think that means that it is going to be more of a mid-game focus for Flipside. The best thing is, while you did mention, we did talk about how Escape are great at pushing and pretty solid at defending, in just a kind of neutral zone when they're kind of farming and split across the map, Flipside have a lot of ways to engage. Obviously, there's a lot of mobility in the Timbersaw, but if Nyx Assassin finds a target in Vendetta, is able to open on him, that will perfectly set up a relocate, which should guarantee a kill.
The level 6s for both these teams is certainly going to bring a lot of fireworks, and we'll have to see which team is going to be able to be off the races at that point first. As we do get the laning stage back and underway here, we'll look to keep tabs as far as the 1-on-1 matchup in the mid lane. That, well, is a 1-1 for now. We have Vanskor, of course, waiting in those wings. Top lane, they do have the early initiative to make a go here with an early mana link. Koshklo could be in a bit of trouble, but it won't be enough to get the finish. It does harass him all the way back, and he will have the tangos. But look at that, sporting two mangoes on top of that. Mango, an item, just doesn't really seem to be the early game thing anymore, but for some...
But for Nyx Assassin, it's actually one of the best, because he actually starts with an absurd amount of starting regen. I think it's like 2.5. So adding on the mangoes on top of this, the first player I remember taking advantage of this was Ice, but just being able to be a nuisance in the lane, stay there forever, and continue to sustain. His mana pool is going to suck. Don't get me wrong about that. It's going to be very hard for him
what
to sustain.
What mana pool? I don't see any mana pool
against,
right now.
The Keep of the Light, but his HP pool, like, you get a poor man's shield and double mango, and the support can do literally nothing to keep you out of the lane.
So Nyx will have to take all those pot shots from the crude old man and suffer from the mana department, but as mentioned, with that heavy sustain, can hang around at least to get some XP. Just needs to be a bit careful here. You know, without any mana, there's no sort of response play. If something like this was to happen, if Yapzor could get in front, he can get a good body block. Yeah. A little bit of a block there, but they're gonna need a lot of auto attacks. He will be able to, as mentioned, eat that mango, turn around, pop off the stun, and just kind of try to waddle his way back. But that reach, even of a level 1 mana leak, able to get close enough right there, will force out a bit of a Vanskor paramedic play, and he will be able to get the assist. But that's a lot of attention. Now they look to go back. Nice two-man stun. Do they have kill potential for Cinder? And it looks like they do! They're going to be able to get him down first. There will be the response kill from Yapzor, taking out the Little Wisp, but it is Flipside who will get the first blood. But if Escape can claim the lives of two, that wouldn't be so shabby. Dendi shows up now, and he will be the one to take down Yapzor. Good plays from Shashklo there. That will draw them in.
Era's out of position as well. Going to be very difficult for him to disengage from this. There's going to be a nice little mana leak on the Timbersaw, but Vanskor keeps bottling up, keeps him sustained. Era with the toss back, but it's not enough. These right clicks doing so much damage between these heroes because Wisp and Tiny both start with zero armor. So Tiny now one armor with the poor man's shield, but it's very, very, very little. While all this was happening, there was a kill on the Beastmaster. It looks like he just overstayed his welcome. The PA and the Witch Doctor have been very aggressive against Kezu's boars. They go, as soon as he pops out a boar, just go immediately go and casket and Stifling Dagger it with a Blightstone and jump on it. They kill those off, they harass back Kezu, and with this early point of Malediction, they were able to force him down to like 20% HP. It looks like he just tried to stick around too long and they were able to dive and kill him while we had the action on mid.
That is a hard hit on the chin already in just what feels like round number one to escape. Maybe kind of second guessing or overestimating their value in some of these little mini skirmishes has led to them kind of being on the bad end of the fight and not by a whole lot either. So now you're seeing huge benefits to someone who should be at like a huge disadvantage, let's say, in this Shotgun Nyx assassin. So suddenly goes from a position where he can't almost hold himself in the lane, and now he's been a part of a couple of kills and he's feeling pretty confident, and he's at about almost level 5 when you compare that over to a Beastmaster who typically on paper is a very, very strong offlaner, but with the circumstances he's been put into, he now falls behind a little bit. So a good head start already for Flipside. Long game ahead of us though, Blaze, so we'll have to see. As we get to our first Nightfall and our 4-minute rune, it is going to be snagged up, a haste rune by that, by Dendi, and with the ping towards mid lane, maybe looking for an approach. We'll wait to see.
Can't help but notice that because Cinderin died before any other heroes in that last exchange, he's actually the lowest by far in experience per minute. He's only got 50 experience per minute, barreling to level 2 at 4.5 minutes. How do you feel about Akadol when he's underfarmed and underleveled like this?
I mean, it sucks. He's now part of like a tri-lane, so obviously the XP split is very thin. He was on that little bit of a wild goose chase, so you can't fault on why he's solo in the XP department. I mean, it's a pub. You can always just go to the jungle and blast your way back into the game, but I don't know how much value Escape have on the importance of having him in that lane. Is he enough of a value now where his level 1 mana leak is good, or is it now too scary to go toe-to-toe with this Nyx assassin already? It's tough. The recovery is, if he's not going to be able to go in the jungle and blast his way back, then it's part of waiting to see if maybe Koikfa can go elsewhere and he can take a lane.
Well, of course, Koikfa does have that Hand of Midas recipe on the core. You're going to be picking that up very shortly, and from there he can jungle, he can pretty much do whatever, push, he can do whatever he wants, and that might give an opportunity for the Caudal to just soak at the very least. Might be a little bit worried about the Nyx Assassin as we approach that Vendetta period. Chachlo closing on level 5 now. But we will notice that Kezu realized that the lane was just getting too difficult, that his boars weren't staying up, and he wasn't able to really contest the lane, so just do it the easy route. Go with the Iron Talon Beastmaster and farm up that jungle with the boars.
Uh-oh.
Piercing damage.
We have Yapzor is feeling a bit frisky, but he was already spotted out, so just as fast as he looks to evade, he'll roll his ass right back home, and will force him to miss an opportunity, but you could feel it. This is that period. Yapzor wants to be able to make that early game impact here. Was able to do so once before, but you know, now he has a couple of skills on his boulder smash, favoring, you know, of course, the heavy-headed damage. Towards the bottom rune, though, rolls all the way past and gets himself stuck up on the high ground. Awkward spot for him, but nonetheless, it will allow Era to grab up the rune.
Yeah, I think if TMW rotated quickly, actually he is going to be heading that direction, should be able to cut off Yapzor, but he's getting that rolling boulder off cooldown shortly, and they just don't have the distance closed. If they Phantom Strike and block it, then they'll have a free kill, but it's very difficult to close that kind of range against a hero with that much mobility. So Team W ends up missing a few CS, Era gets himself the rune, and we kind of reset back to normalcy.
Yeah, but you can kind of feel the anxiousness in the air. Mid lane, Dendi tossed back close to the tower. Cute play by Era. Is going to be able to get a payoff? It doesn't look like it. Dendi's able to shrug off a lot of the damage as the reactive armor ticks begin to come in, plus with Yapzor there.
Wow!
They get him down! Era tosses forward the creep, and it's going to be enough. Dendi to drop and Escape clinch together their second kill of the game.
Yeah, Siege Creep hits him for his last 23 HP, and that will bring him down. That is a brutal loss there for Dendi, but it comes down to the build. You don't often see this earlier points of Timber Chains here. It allows you to surprise your enemy with a little bit more burst damage, a little bit more aggression around the tree line, but in this kind of zone without any trees, it's just open area in the mid lane, you're wanting more and more points of reactive armor just to survive. He clearly took a lot of auto attacks under the tower there and just didn't get enough to survive.
We have a Vendetta Nyx Assassin now.
Oh, but great warning.
Yeah, as mentioned, fantastic wardage here from Escape. They have anticipated the roaming will be coming. seems pretty straightforward. Nyx is missing. He might be level 6. He is level 6, so let's make sure we have preparations in order and escape do so. But top lane, he's made his reapproach. Looking to go for Koikfa as Koikfa's trying to get a tier 1. So now he's very low on life, and I don't think there's too many options there for them to stop. The dagger will connect. A few more spirits should be able to clinch it. It is going to be TMW who flies on in and will be able to snag it up. And 4-2 will be on your score for Flipside.
You hate to see that death when Midas has been off cooldown for maybe 20 seconds. Just didn't see the creep to break it down. And now that's just going to be that efficiency lost. He's been having a free farm lane up to this point, top net worth, but could be so much sweeter if he was able to just cycle his Midas cooldown to cooldown. But that's a good rotation from TMW. We're going to see pressure bottom as well as Chachlo makes a move in Vendetta.
TP'd, Vendetta gets the strike, gets the stun. Roger's here too with the pop of the Maledict here. I don't think Kazoo will be able to have enough to stand, but Yapzor is coming by his side to at least get a little bit of redemption for the takedown. They actually will get the kill first, so Kazoo is a part of the XP pie, and he actually lives on, but nah, there. Shotgun will be able to bring him down with the Impale, but it could turn into a 2-for-1 as constant right-clicks and boar action will continue backing under the tower. With no one else rotating in from Flipside, they make it work.
Yeah, and unfortunately, no TPs available here. The relocate's still not online, so that is going to be a very nice dive here from Escape, taking it 2-for-1, and this offlaner for offlaner, so happy to take that exchange. It just it could have been a very different fight if the cast could come out a little bit later, a little bit more patience.
Oh, Era might walk into some free, sweet loot. Moves in, gets off the pop, takes down the Wisp, and says, I'll take your creeps too. Beautiful steal of money right there for him.
Yeah, very timely maneuver here, and it's going to get him very close to a Blink Dagger at an extremely fast pace. He's got this Windlace as well as the grow passive to give him 390 base movement speed, but he's looking for even more flourish with the Blink Dagger that will soon be there. Dire's middle
tower is under attack. He has eyes for Dendi, who's actually very low on life here. Has to be a bit careful. Pings are out. They feel like something's nearby. It's going to be Era. He moves in and tries to go for the nuke. It is going to be Vanskor. Shows up just in time. Get baited, sir.
Yeah. There's just too much distance there. I'm actually really surprised he went for that. Bottom, we're going to see the unveilment of that Vendetta. Maledict will come a little bit late, but Kazu locked in with the creep. I have double bounce of the cask, and that will certainly be a dead Beastmaster. So I am actually a little bit surprised to see how much prioritization that Roger has been putting on this Maledict. I feel like if you're able to get a really fast Aether Lens, you can show value. Actually, relocate just for counter pressure, I guess. I'm not exactly sure what the full plan was there, but this Maledict build is actually quite interesting to me because when you have Voodoo Restoration on a Wisp and the hero that the Wisp is tethered to, you can actually multiply that value by 2.5 in terms of what you're actually healing the primary target for. Along with that Maledict, it's kind of got a range issue where we have a lot of heroes that if Ridgewalker is close enough to Maledict somebody, he's close enough to get tiny comboed, for example. So I look at this like an issue where unless you have like an Aether Lens, you're probably going to be putting yourself in a very dangerous position just to get the spell out. It's gotten them at least one or two kills, but I would actually have gone for the Voodoo Restoration much more, so at least 1 point.
Back in behind the mid lane tower, they got Roar on said Roger here. As they try to keep him alive, there is going to be a drop of the Magnetize. They will be splitting a kill, one apiece right now. The Ebola does begin to spread. It's going to be very painful here for Vanskor, but the rock refreshments continue to pop out from Yapzor. He's looking to go for the finish. Is it going to be enough time? Vanskor has to jump back in, and he actually jumps back into another tick and will get himself taken down. But it is a favorable trade, it looks like, for Flipside, as they will take it 3-4. Absolute bloodshed in the mid lane.
Looks like Quickful will be able to take the bottom tier one as this bear pushes so damn fast with the battle cry up and no glyph to just deal with it. So, all in all, still a great fight for Flipside. I love the fact that Dendi was able to block out the rolling bolter from the Earth Spirit, but unfortunately, with not enough raw HP and magical mitigation, he actually ends up going down as well on the tail end of it. So, it's still Escape that are controlling the map. While Flipside are leading in kills, Escape are suppressing the Radiant side, and they're actually breaking down towers more rapidly. This is going to give less space for the PA to accelerate for Dendi to start farming in the jungle, and it's going to make things harder as the time goes by.
I don't think if you're Flipside, you want to be neglecting Koikfa too much here. They're getting what feels like the better end of a lot of these trades, but with Koikfa continuing to farm up, he almost has that kind of alchemist factor to him that is just a constant greedy force that is even better at being able to play the objective kind of a game. So it is something that we'll have to stay in check by Flipside, or he could turn into quite the sleeping dragon. And this is what nightmares are made of. exactly in the bottom lane. This creep on the Coddle right now, and he's dead as shit for sure. See you later, Cinderin. It was nice knowing you. Oh, my God.
In top lane, they're actually going to be able to get a really good flank here onto the Timbersaw as well. Dendi will be going down once again. This is not the start you want for Timbersaw. I did fine in lane. Dendi was able to actually outlast hit substantially. He's 79 last hits with Era only having 45, but Era gets the last lap. He's got 3 kills. Yeah, he did die 3 times, but he got 2 assists as well. He's been very oriented around the combat, and it's just getting kills on the higher priority targets like this Timber.
And if the Timber is kind of stutter-stepping a bit his way into the mid-game, that is not looking so good for the overall like storyboard for Flipside, because I don't know if this PA is quite ready to be able to kind of fill that position as being the heavy-handed hitter at the moment. Already committing for what looks like an early rush to the Desolator now. I mean, don't get me wrong, Blaze, those daggers could end up doing some serious work. So, I mean, we'll have to see. If RNG is going to be with her at this point, it could lead to utter destruction, but we'll have to keep tabs. Top lane, we're getting a bit of a congregation here. A deep dive in. Dendi looking to go for the move. He's going to force Yapzor into the Magnetize. Era responds, tries to dish out the stun. Not going to be able to do enough work to get down the Wisp, but instead they will lose Yapzor. But it is going to be Dendi eating the bulk and a lot of that Magnetize damage. He will be fine. Vanscore reunites with him, but nice catch of the cast. Locked between two. Easily leads to their destruction, and Escape will lose 3 all day.
They're just sustaining themselves through the bottle and the urn here, and that's going to be enough for them to keep the fight rolling.
Party does not stop. The party bus has moved, and it's at mid lane now. As the tower will drop, they look to go for Koikfa, but the Savage Roar is going to be there. Will not stop them, though, for claiming the extra bounty of the panda.
Koikova still gets the tower for it. 300 gold goes the other way, but he does get to resummon immediately and get right back to farm. So Koikova's still having the game of his life. He's able to pick up that Sacred Relic now and move in very quickly towards Radiance. And it feels like Flipside actually have to start getting something accomplished on the dire side of the map before that Radiance comes out.
Dendi's going for Yapzor. Yapzor pulling out what he can to stop Dendi from the chase. And as good as Earth Spirit, and I know he's able to be mobile, Timbersaw can just mobile his ass all over him and just chases him down. So with that, they'll claim an extra life and not get the last hit on the tower, but they will be able to claim the tower nonetheless. And Flipside will take the extra bit of economy while they can. We check over the overall net worth now, and we're pretty much even.
Yeah, it is even in this state, but I have to look at Escape, and I feel like they've accomplished their objectives much more. So they've taken every outer tier one. They've gotten the Radiance up on the bear, at least they will, in 500 gold. And they've got the Assassination build up on the Tiny. Like, he can kill anybody at level 9 with these items, just straight up. So with this in mind, you have the full potential for Era to keep controlling the map through like this assassination, this ability to jump on targets as we will look towards mid.
Exhibit A, possibly? We'll see. Uh-oh. Tame My Wild running back into what could be the open arms of a bit of trouble here, but Era actually doesn't see it happening. So once he recognizes the mid lane is missing, he will take his business elsewhere. And I guess just like two ships in the night, they will cross each other's paths without even knowing it.
Yeah. But even still, like, he has the potential to find those openings, to find those bursts, as long as he has Hawk Vision or Ward Vision. And then, in the meantime, Koikova is just going to keep farming and keep building himself up to a massive status.
Cinderin gets a little pressure down on the bottom lane as Flipside are moving their own posse through the north here. Spotted out the Koikova bear and will look to claim the jungle for themselves, trying their best to be able to restrict the farm for Escape. And obviously we have recognized, I'm sure they have, that Koikva has been able to kind of do as he pleases and being able to kind of accumulate so much net worth. And Flipside are looking to stunt that as much as possible, but possible smoke movement here from Escape as they look to really kind of take the initiative.
Yeah, this is not going to be seen out at all by Flipside. They might be a little bit wary, but it should be somebody that gets caught. The question is who. Arrow jumps on Dendi, able to find him out, toss him back to his team, and down he will go.
Quick catch, and Kezu's looking for the next target. He gets a nice, beautiful roar onto Roger. Goes for the Valiant TP, not going to be able to get it, though. Courier has to be a bit of trouble here, but that coconut is not going to be enough to stop it. They take the Courier, too. Quickly escape fire back. They get a couple of kills, a Courier, and now moving towards a Tier 2 in the mid lane.
And while Flipside may be able to take the bottom tier one, obviously Escape didn't glyph there, but they're going to be able to push out in the mid so very fast. Inner Beast max out, Vladimir's max out. This bear is going to just chunk down this tower.
And Flipside will have to do something about it, or maybe not. Maybe they just have to kind of take this one and accept the fact that their outer towers could be crumbling fast and have a better chance of being able to split the difference elsewhere. But here we go. Yapzor moves in, looking to casually harass and do some work between the two.
Oh,
oh my
wow.
God, the huge crit! And now Yapzor's in trouble. I'm getting hit by the spear balls. He goes down. And back at mid lane, we see Dendi stepping in, but the Savage Roar will create a little bit of space for an escape to escape, but Kazoo doesn't seem like he'll be fortunate enough to do so. And TMW is a part of yet another kill. From bottom lane to mid, he's all over the map.
All right, so the Beastmaster is actually going to be... Oh, as Vanscore. That relocate. Rubber Van's back the other way.
Yeah.
As often can happen, the Wisp will die immediately thereafter. So the Beastmaster is actually going to be going for a Crimson Guard here. This is not actually an item that jumped out to me at this point in the game. Like, usually, like, I'm actually one of the casters that'll, like, you know what, oh, this is a great game for Timbersaw. These heroes are attacking fast. These guys are hitting for too little of damage, but it's actually quite surprising here. I mean, yeah, you get that buff on the Spear Bear, which is pretty nice, but, yeah, PA can still hit really hard. She hits fast, but she also hits very, very hard, and the rest of the damage is really coming in from either the Magical Impure of the Timbersaw or the Witchdoctor's Death Ward, which cannot be blocked by Crimson, so... End of the day, I think it's kind of an average pick for them to keep the momentum rolling. Maybe even could have seen like an Arcane Mech build up instead. But all the same, they clearly want to try to take a mid-game stride and try to take their advantage while they have it on Quakeva's net worth.
As Escape look to hopefully make that kind of mid-game impact, we do have a Shotchkill here casually poking at Era for that rune.
Uh-oh.
And Aaron makes his move. It's going to be a jump onto Dendi. Another toss back. This time Dendi. Oh, not going to be able to timber chain away. Kazoo will be there with the roar. They commit a lot, and they will bring down the machine. And Dendi will be put out for about 20 seconds time.
I really do feel like if Flipside are going to bring this back, it's going to be over the next like 10 minutes with Dendi as well as TMW just really stepping up their game. They need to start snowballing, building up Bloodstone charges, getting PA'd another item or two. Otherwise, they're just going to be outmatched by currently Escape's just overwhelming force. Era jumping in bottom, able to get a great combo on TMW,
oh!
While the dagger will crit. Vanscore can't get the relocate out. It's going to be Yapzor who cancels the relocate, but TMW turns it with the crit.
And he's got to get another. Oh, man. One punch is all it takes right there. He just blasts down Yapzor. Vanscore lives on, and he's just like, what the hell happened before my Wisp eyes? He'll settle, go back, be able to get the gem, but... has a two-man takedown, thanks to the RNGesus. While at the top lane here, it looks like the Panda will also be taken apart. Flipside will claim an extra bit of bounty, or not. This bear's fast. Okay, they will be able to chase it. It's a long-winded chase. But Koifa might be able to fake it away here. Maldictic, this is like a friggin' highway pursuit.
Wow. That's actually going to work out for him. He's going to be able to recall it as soon as this Maledict wears off, and that's going to be... Oh!
Ah!
A missed opportunity from Chachlo. So gem is quite a big pickup in this case. It's just going to give a lot better control over the map. Maybe you'll see a Hawk that shouldn't be there and make sure that you're able to, say, approach the Roshan pit when Escape are trying to make their move there. But in the meantime, Era getting massive, going to have that Echo Saber very soon. Koikova even more so, just building himself up very quickly. And they're going to be able to just kind of, in my mind, just go control the Rosh Pit, go for the Aegis, and go for the Tier 3s.
Definitely still feels like Escape have the better kind of objective game. Flipside have kind of really been able to kind of flex their muscle and their damage potential and their hero kill ability. But, you know, as far as the overall swing of the game and how much Escape are going to be able to do what's important in taking those towers and pushing into the base. They have that initiative, so we'll have to see what Flipside can do to kind of defend and hold, because it looks like trouble could be approaching in the bottom lane. Roger moves in, pops off the cask. It's only going to catch onto the single Yapzor. Yapzor will lose his own life for being that scout on the front lines here. Not the biggest loss to Escape, but with him taken out of the picture, I don't think they can move forward with any sort of game plan here at the bottom.
Yeah, that was just a situation where the Air Spirit blinked in a little bit too far. Just try to get the ward down or maybe get a quick catch instead.
Oh, wow, look at this.
At least him and looks like Kezu as well.
They cut him off. Vanscore moves in front, and they will be able to get the catch on the Beastmaster here. And Flipside pull together another one, and their kill count moves ahead 22 to Escape's 14. Net worth, though, still at the same. Just all that credit to Koifa continuing to farm up on the Lone Druid. He's at the king of the net worth right now. And it's not until you get to air in that fourth position for the next Escape target. But here goes Flipside into the Roche Pit Blaze, feeling pretty confident that they'd be able to move in there and get it started, but not the biggest bulk of damage to do it fast enough.
Mm-hmm. Looks like they kind of called an audible on the Beastmaster's item trajectory. He went for like a buckler, ring of health, and stout shield. I'm like, okay, that's a Crimson Guard. And then now he's got the headdress. So he's going back for a mechanism despite having bought up almost the whole Vanguard. And we'll go from there.
Cinderin is dead. Solo kill there by Roger as he gets off the Witch Doctor combo. We'll do the work. Oh, Yapzor jumping in. Nice sidestep there. As Roger will be able to avoid the boulder smash, the geometric grip will be able to connect with the silence, and then with Koifa being able to step in, his bear just shreds apart the little witch doctor. And Nyx Assassin will casually be there to kind of scout what's happening. And I think they have the idea that Escaper moving in for the rush.
Yeah, unfortunately it's going to be very difficult to deal with this. The battle cry can be popped off towards the tail end of this, and it's going to be a very, very fast Roshan kill.
I don't think there's too many options here for Flipside to interject, but they are creeping that way like they want to consider doing something about it. Cinderin's coming back now and could end up crossing paths with the Nyx Assassin. If not careful, he actually drops the sentry to the high ground. There's the jump in from Shotglow, connects with a beautiful stun. The movement follow-up from TMW is going to lead to the takedown of Era. Now the Roar counterplay comes up from Kezu. Flipside going to get bumped apart a bit by Cinder, but Cinder is going to be quickly taken down just as fast as he comes back. No! Stun is there, and Denny's going to have no mana, but there goes TMW, being able to jump in, being able to finish the job. Yapzor moves in, pops off the Magnetize, and, well, it looks like Shotglow wants to come back for another round of play. Magnetize continues as more rocks are going to be dropped here. Vanskor trying to make it back in a way, but the bear continues his chase and should be able to get the finish, while on the other side, PA makes destruction as he's going to be bringing down that Beastmaster. And she's not done there yet, looking to go for the bear and claim some extra bits of gold. We'll only be able to smack him up with a bit of a crit. But Flipside, notoriously able to do their job, keeping away Escape and interjecting when they're trying to get that Roche done. Now, they double back and finish it off.
Yeah,
it looks like that's
definitely
the case. It's so low.
Absolutely.
What a beautiful steal by them.
Absolutely insane. Flipside going in a situation where they absolutely could have lost this fight, but they knew they had to take a risk here. They let the game play itself out. They'd be facing an Aegis. They'd be facing a really tough high ground defense. Instead, they get a fresh PKB at TMW, and they go in. Now, I have to say, there was a mistake. There was miscommunication coming in from Escape, because it seemed like the Beastmaster, Kezu, actually thought that it was just a snipe attempt from the Nyx Assassin. He goes and he roars the Nyx immediately after he had already popped out his Impale Vendetta, or sorry, his Impale and Spike Carapace. But what you really need to do is control TMW. And now this is the last bear. Oh no! He doesn't have a bear for 35 seconds. Guaranteed tier 2 and moving in towards tier 3 quickly. The most important thing you could do in this game is control the Phantom Assassin. You've seen what she did bottom lane, just tearing apart two heroes into mid-speed, and now in that last fight, breaking down Tiny, their main damage dealer, in a fraction of a second.
Oh my god, and it doesn't stop yet. Flipside continue to just demolish everything in their path down this mid lane. And Escape, a team we were praising for their own heavy push power, are going to be the team who do get their own base pushed in. Flipside going to work. Cinderin was one of their best options to be able to kind of push out these waves and relieve this pressure, but without being the biggest factor at the moment, that doesn't seem to be happening. And suddenly, Rax is exposed, nearly halfway dead. This melee Rax is set to fall. This could be a bit of a gimp right now for Escape and being able to kind of come back for game one.
Yeah, they weren't able to control the Roche fight the way they needed to. This PA is running over them. I haven't seen him blinded. I haven't seen him roared. This guy's just been able to do whatever he wants. He had BKB against the crack before the Kraggy came out. He never got entangled. Like, TMW has a Wisp behind him, which already turns any normal hero into a hard carry. But when you believe in your crits the way TMW has his coup de grace, like, you're in just for an amazing game of Dota 2. And TMW is showing it here, styling on his opponents, critting all over, and completely turning this game 180, where I felt like the natural progression of this game was for Escape to take the Aegis, for Escape to take the high ground, and at least have a Rax advantage, and then that Flipside would have to bring it back. Now it's completely the opposite. Flipside were able to fight into that pit, manly as all get out, jumping in was the Nyx to lead the charge, and by forcing out that roar on himself, TMW could just go ham. Now he's in a great spot where he's got 3,800 gold baked up. He's got a 9-second BKB. He's ready to rumble.
I feel like I was getting ready at the point when he had just completed his Vlad's rather to be like, okay, Blaze, you know, is he able to set himself enough time to be able to at least go for this BKB, because that has to be critical to him. And before I can even lead back to that discussion, he already has the frickin' BKB. He gets that huge fight. He has so much extra lump sum of gold to add on top of it that she looks pretty damn indestructible. And I can't imagine, I don't get to play PA too much, but when you land those big crits and you get those kills, it's got to be one of the most goddamn gratifying things ever.
Absolutely. Visually, audibly, and just as a whole. But I really do feel like it was that bottom turnaround where he got a little bit of luck, a little bit of RNG to get those double crits. Winning that fight got him that BKB by the time the Roche fight came out, which got him the Roche. So really, really good chain of events for Flipside and for TMW. And as we mentioned at the beginning of this game, it's very important they take this win if they want to survive throughout the group. So they are getting this point of leverage, and now it's Escape's game to try to take back.
We have to see what is plan B. Possibly here for Escape, and is there even a plan B? Or have they gone too far with the setup they have and being able to try to just put emphasis in hoping that they would already be up and ahead at this point? So, feeling a bit of pressure. They've smoked up, and they were hoping for a scouting opportunity to make a gank happen or some sort of counterplay against Flipside here in the bottom lane, but Flipside already have business elsewhere. They've been continuing up with their farm game, looking to accumulate those next big item grabs before they look to make their next initial strike. It is the back end of their Aegis timing, so if they wanted to get some use out of their secondary life, they are going to probably have to put to use here very, very soon. So we wait and anticipate whether Flipside are going to be anxious to make their move or not. They are now going to be heading towards the bottom lane, so we'll have to see if Escape try to make a new way to kind of, you know, perch themselves in a position for any sort of jump.
Yeah, awkward spot for them right now. This is just Tame My Wild remains untamed. He's actually looking to pounce behind the tower at anybody who tries to defend it. Obviously, if like Cinderin was trying to illuminate the wave, that he'd be dead in a matter of seconds. And Team W is not pushing down outside. They don't really want to break high ground here, but they're pushing down the tier 2 with 5,000 gold banked up on the Phantom Assassin. I say they don't want to push high ground. Maybe they're confident up in the Aegis, but he has 4K gold. He just bought out a VIP booster looking for something big.
And not to be stopped now. Gets the overcharge and begins to go to the work on the tier 3. Does force the rest of Escape to get back in attendance here. And Escape have to do a bit of a test of their high ground defense once more. TMW happy to kind of
Aegis
be that
gone. Get out. I don't think you fight this anymore. Like, Aegis is gone and you have 4,000 gold unspent. Maybe 5,000 if you consider the courier. You don't want to keep fighting here.
I don't know if Flipside want to heed your advice just yet, Blaze. They're still hanging around and waiting for maybe a second go around, or maybe they're hoping that Escape just kind of lollygag a bit and walk out from the front door carelessly. But
they've got like a full abyssal waiting. Like, just wait a little bit, get the courier here at least, and they'll be able to make something of it. But you can't buy a ring of health on the battlefield, so I guess he's gonna have to wait.
He gets the basher at least in hand for now, so abyssal that much closer.
He'll probably do the diligent thing and save for buyback. Right now he's got 380 surplus, so in about 800 gold he'll be picking up that abyssal for himself.
But not looking to spread too far apart. It looks like whether they are going to be waiting a little bit for the extra gold pieces, they are overall still with the mindset, still with the game plan that they want to kind of hang here from the south and be able to kind of make their move from the lower part of Escape's base. They have a Nyx Assassin on the prowl. Ooh, blink in, stun, swing and a miss, and a relocate coming in. They're trying to retreat on the side of Escape, but Cinderin seems to be the one man left behind now. And even though a Blinding Light will help pull them back it away, a TP is not going to allow them to make the escape. Dendi will be able to make the move in, and they get the finish, not just on him, but on the bear too.
Yeah. And I think the bear's enough incentive to go in. Like, yeah, you killed the Caudle, but even better, you killed Quikva's bear. He just resummoned it. If you kill this bear, there's no such thing as a buyback for the Spirit Bear. A refresher orb might be the equivalent
You're
here.
Stuck with Quikva with boots and a TP, and that is not a good hero. That is not a hero at all, actually. So, with the mid lane being finished out, and with the bottom lane looking like it could start to fall, we can't help it hold our breath for Escape to see what their defense is going to be. And for Flipside, man, they're bringing their game. They know they need to get this win, and they are not looking to leave without it. They get the tier 3 down. These bottom Raxes are totally out and in the open.
It's so hard to kill them. They've got a mech on the wisp. They got Voodoo Restoration, but a nice initiation from Yasuo. But will it be enough?
Full man stun. They're looking for the magnetize. They're looking for the AoE. Is it going to be enough? It doesn't look like it here. They follow it up with the roar, but TMW not taking any sort of follow-up damage. Now begins to go on his own warpath. His first target is going to be Cinderin, who is going to be sliced apart. The only one to go down. The rest of Escape head on back and into the safety net.
Oh no, the bear!
Jump in, bear. If he's out, he's out for good, and he's down. Era could be next, and this could be the beginning of the end for Escape of game number one. And more importantly, Flipside look to go for lives. That's going to be it. The towel has been thrown in game one. Goes to Flipside in this two-game series.
It all comes down to Tame My Wild just going ham. I'd love to praise Dendi as everybody wants to, but he had a pretty average game here. He didn't really snowball the way he was looking to as a Timbersaw. He had good CS, but a bit of a rough exchange between Era, who was able to get some really good Avatos initiations. In the end, we got to look at this PA and realize just how untamed he got to be in this game. I mean, he was able to run around without getting disabled hardly at all. He got one blinding light against him, like, 2 minutes ago, but other than that, he's been able to do everything he wanted to, because he roars him in the last fight, but by then it's too late. He's too big. He's got too much going for him. Tame My Wild, that's the graphs you want to look at. That's the hero of the game right here, because with the Wisp behind him, they did end up maxing Voodoo Restoration thereafter, as well as getting a Mechanism and then Guardian Greets on the Wisp. This allows you to just go in so hard as a PA, because you've got essentially like a health bar and a half at least to back you up. So getting that Aegis with the life insurance allowed them to take the mid lane, and then getting the Wisp behind you in those kinds of situations gave him all the confidence he needed to just break through the enemy backline. And yeah, that really was all about him. He got, I will admit, a decent bit of luck with some of those crits there, especially the bottom lane 2v2.
But that, you know, that's what you're getting into when you even go for the PA. Yeah,
that's how
games work out. And it's crazy. I mean, because we were looking at this game on paper and we were like, this looks pretty good for Escape. I mean, they have everything they could ask for. They have the demolition squad to kind of move on forward. But yeah, a couple of crazy situations like that, a couple of, you know, winks coming out from RNGesus, and suddenly the game is not going the way you planned. And I'm very anxious to see how Escape are going to be changing things up and if they want to risk having those kind of unfortunate opportunities their way for game two. But props to Flipside. They'll take game one. We'll take a bit of a break. And when we come back, it will be game two of Escape versus Flipside. That's Blaze. I'm Kyle Guy, and we'll see you soon for the next match.